Morning. It's nice to see familiar faces. I hope everyone had a wonderful week. Welcome to Second City Church. If you are new, we're glad you're here, and if you're returning, we're glad you're back. If you would please stand with me for our call to worship.
Grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Amen. Let's take a moment, silently prepare our hearts to worship the Lord. A Great God, we come to you this morning to worship you, to hear you call us to yourself. And for some of us, Lord, in the beauty of this day, we come and we hear words like, it is good and right to sing praises to your name. And we feel that, Lord. We come with the joy of the sun shining upon us and the amazement that the God who made this beautiful day covenants with us and loves us and meets with us. And Lord, for some of us, we hear words like how good and right it is to go to the house of the Lord. And we think of how lonely it can be to come to church and how strange it can be and how awkward it might be. Or we wonder if our doubts have gotten so big that we don't belong, or all kinds of reasons, Lord. I pray, Lord, this morning that for each person that comes into this place that you would meet us. Lord, that your face would shine upon us, whether we are glad and our hearts are lifted up and our heads are lifted up to you, or we come wondering and questioning and wondering where our place is. God, make your face to shine upon us this morning. And receive our worship in the name of Jesus, our great mediator, our great savior, our great friend. Let's hear this call to worship this morning from Psalm 147. Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
For it is good to sing praises to our God, for it is pleasant, and a song of praise is fitting. The Lord builds up Jerusalem. He gathers the outcasts of Israel. He heals the brokenhearted and binds up their wounds. He determines the number of the stars. He gives to all of them their names. Great is our Lord and abundant in power. His understanding is beyond measure. The Lord lifts up the humble. He casts the wicked to the ground. Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Amen.
Cry out to you.
Scripture tells us that when we confess our sins, he hears. And we have the confidence to know that we're forgiven because of Jesus. So we're going to take some time to confess through this hymn, and then we'll take some time to confess independently and silently before we confess together as a church. Let us confess our sins before God and one another. Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Brothers and sisters, I was talking to Jed earlier this week. He didn't know I was going to say this, but I'm going to say this. And he was telling me that he was able to have this lovely conversation with one of his daughters about the doctrine of double imputation. And it was a very theological kind of term, and yet his daughter was able to grasp the beauty of this. And I thought, oh my goodness, this is something that seems like a long phrase, theological jargon. Excuse me. I've got something in my throat. But it's so beautiful, so life-giving, and this is what it is, that the Lord, the Father in heaven, looks upon you with the righteousness and goodness of Christ because Jesus took all of your sins away on the cross. He got your sins, you get his righteousness. Listen to these words then from 2 Corinthians. I thought after that conversation, I was like, they've got to hear this again. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, for your sake, he made him to be sin, who knew no sin, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. What good news. Brothers and sisters, in Christ Jesus, our sins are forgiven.
Thanks be to God.
Amen. Thanks be to God indeed. The Lord loves you. Love one another and pass the peace of Christ to one another. Peace, Lord, be with you.
Also with you.
Thank you. Greet one another in the name of the Lord.
We do want to sing of your goodness and your love all of our days. Teach us to pray honestly but gratefully and faithfully like David, as we've seen again and again in these Psalms, and let us always remember your goodness even in times of hardship, even when there's the appearance of failing or unfaithfulness for you. We know that is just not true. And your love is deep and strong and faithful.
Thank you.
Lord, we think of how this idea of your running after us is so central to the good news of your grace to us. It was when we were still far off, strangers, aliens, enemies, that you brought us near, that you made us family, friends. In the goodness of our Lord, you run after us, Lord. Jesus, you're sent by the Father in pursuit of a world running away, and you draw us near. God, we're thankful for that. We're thankful that you're the missionary God, and what we see throughout Scripture is you're making a missionary people. God, we worship you this morning for these beautiful truths. We adore you, Lord. We thank you that your goodness is displayed in the pursuit of us. Thank you that your promise to us this morning is that you're with us. Jesus, you're the great worship leader singing over your people, the mediator between us and the Father. Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, we worship you and we adore you this morning. Amen. You may be seated. What we've sought to do is to have the fourth Sunday of the month be a time where we can highlight something going on with our missionaries, missions, and whatnot. And this morning, well, after the service today, you're going to have an opportunity, if you're interested, to hear more about our desire and our plan to build this year an ESL program here at the church. And so Sarah Foos is going to come and share a little bit about that hope and what's going on there. Sarah, probably this mic is best.
Good morning. So I am honored today to get to give a report from our missions team. And we have been praying for a long time about different missions opportunities around the world. And we've realized that some of those opportunities are right here in Harrisburg. And there are a number of people right around here who would probably not be able to go and do open missions in their country, but they've come to us. So I just want to share a brief scripture from Matthew 22 when Jesus said, love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind. This is the first and greatest commandment. And the second is like it. Love your neighbor as yourself. All the law and the prophets hang on these two commandments. So we have some new neighbors in Harrisburg and the greater Harrisburg area. We have some neighbors who have come from far away and are far from their home, and a lot of them don't speak English. So we can neighbor them. We can be good neighbors and be fulfilling God's command to us by helping come alongside them in a lot of different ways. But one way that we are looking at doing with our church is through an ESL ministry. So I don't have exact statistics on how many recent, how much immigration we've had recently to our area from specific countries, but we have people from Nepal, from Africa, from Congo, from Somalia, from Ukraine, from Afghanistan, Iraq, and the Philippines, all kinds of different countries. And I was blessed yesterday to get to go to an ESL conference locally where all the different churches in our area who have ESL programs met together to see how we could coordinate really well. And there are a ton of ESL programs, and most of them have long waiting lists to get into. So they are really thrilled for us to be starting something in Midtown. None of the churches represented there were actually from Midtown. There are a couple ESL programs in Midtown, but none of them were churches. And so they are thrilled that instead of turning people away who are currently on their waiting list, they might be able to send them to us. Oh, sorry, thank you. So ESL stands for English as a Second Language. So
some people just call them English classes, but some churches said, well, why are we offering in English classes? Don't we all speak English already? Well, we might, but not everybody who might live next door to our church or next door to us does speak English. And so here's what we need from you in our church. We need volunteers. You don't need to know how to teach anything. You don't need to be a teacher. If you're just willing to be a neighbor to someone from another country, then we will train you and we will help you find a volunteer position that you're comfortable with. We're not going to force you to be the lead teacher if that's not what you want, but we will. We need volunteers who eventually will need some people who will be trained as teachers. We need some childcare volunteers, and we'll need some helpers for the teachers. Just if you speak English, if you love Jesus, and if you're willing to help out, then we can use you. And we can talk more about that at the meeting after the service today. The other need we have that we need from all of you is prayer. We need your prayer support for this ministry. Even if you're not able to help out, please pray for us. Pray for us as we are building our team, and also pray for us going forward. And we also need students. So if you know anyone who needs ESL classes, please spread the word. We might fill up really quickly, in which case we'll be coming back asking for more volunteers. So I think we need to start, we'll probably have a team of about 10 to 15 volunteers, depending on how many students we have. We might need to grow that team, but we have a good group already, but we're still looking to add about 5 more volunteers for our launch. So if this sounds interesting to you, you don't have to sign in blood, but if it sounds interesting, please come talk to us after the meeting in the corner over here. After the service, we'll have a meeting to talk about that. Thank you.
Let me say a couple things quickly about that. One thing I want to say is that Sarah and Val have been praying about this for a good while, and it has been sort of a something that we've just been talking about and praying about, and is this sort of a good thing for our church to do? That is this something we ought to pursue at this time? And we think this is a good thing for our church in many regards, but one of the things is that this kind of service is a great way of fellowship. Like, one of the desires for our church is, how do we connect people with one another? You know, it's so easy to come on Sunday and then just leave and not really feel like you get connected with people. This kind of service is one where you're working together and you're seeing each other kind of regularly. And you're really, it's sort of like functions in some ways like a community group where you actually get to talk and be with one another regularly. And so there's something really beautiful about that. But the other thing is that this really is just a huge need in our community. This summer, actually, the director for English or ESL, English as a Second Language for Catholic Charities, called me up and said, hey, I have a student who lives in your neighborhood who can't drive and really needs tutoring. Can I just use your church building space and I can meet with this person? Because she didn't know where she could send this student who's recently moved to the U.S. And I said, of course you can. And so they met here in this space. But there is immediate local, our neighborhood need for this kind of way of loving our neighbors. So if it really, as Sarah said, if it just kind of piques your interest, you're like, I could maybe do that. And I don't know, maybe I should just find out more. The meeting is planning for like 10 minutes, 15 minutes. Just stick around and learn a little bit after the service. I wanted to mention one other thing that you can find in your announcements, and that's that on the 16th of September, we're gonna do an Intro to Second City class. If you're kind of new, if you're just checking out the church, this is a good opportunity to learn a little bit more. It is a Saturday morning, 8:30 to noon, so it's a little bit of a time commitment. But we do ask, if you're kind of interested in membership or if you're just learning, you want to learn more about the church, come to that. Contact me, grab me and say, hey, Peter, I'm going to come, or shoot me an email. My email's on the back of the bulletin or whatever. Please let me know if you're interested. I'd love for you to come and be a part of that. This is our last Sunday with children in the service. Children, I'm glad you're in the service. I really am. I love having you with us. We don't have a lot of younger kids who'd be gone, but children, I'm really glad you're with us. There are children's bulletins in the back and crayons. If you do some drawings or whatever and you're like, oh, this totally relates to the sermon, I would love to see them. Sometimes you show them to me. I really do like getting to see what you create. I was talking to Kathy Prescott before the service, and she takes notes, and I know other people take notes. Kids, sometimes you learn really well by drawing pictures, and that kind of helps you remember things. And so maybe show me those. Let me pray for our children, then we'll hear from Psalm 64. Lord in heaven, we're really thankful as parents and as a church that you say that the children of those who love you belong to you and that you love them. That's consistent throughout all the Bible. God, we pray for the children of this church that their hearts would be warmed more and more to you, that they would love you, that they would desire you, that they would delight in your word and walk in your path. And God, we pray for them even today as they're with us here in the service, that their ears would be open, their hearts would be receptive, their bodies wouldn't be too wiggly, and that you give their parents patience. Lord, bless these children, we ask in Jesus' name, amen. Before I read this scripture, I did want to mention a couple things that I'd like you to pray about. One is Mary Watts is back home, thank the Lord. She spent a couple weeks in the hospital. So please pray for Mary as she recovers and whatnot. The other thing is Christine Perrin had her surgery this week. It was extensive, and it's going to be a long road to recovery. So please remember Christine Perrin in your prayers. And then I just wanted to mention, Amy's going to mention this later on, but there are so many in our church who are involved in education. Lots of teachers, lots of students, and lots of administrators and whatnot. Please remember one another in your prayer at this time, at the beginning of the school year. Lift one another up before the Lord. You'll have an opportunity to do that in our service later. Psalm 64. Rejoice in the Lord and take refuge in him. Why would that need to be said? Lots of reasons. I'll tell you a few. Sometimes we think we need to take matters into our own hands. Maybe God can't be a refuge. Not doing things the way we want. Sometimes we think, man, God takes too long. Is he going to come through anyway? Refuge after waiting so long? Sometimes it seems like things aren't where you think they should be and happening in the way that you think they should happen, and well, something needs to be done about it. Sometimes, and this is, I bet this is true of all of us, sometimes it seems like the pleasures of the world are just too enticing. They're too shiny and beautiful, and they could make us feel good, and rejoicing in the Lord and taking refuge in him doesn't seem as attractive. Here's the thing, we're often tempted to think that dependence on God and taking refuge in him alone is not going to get us where we need to go. He might not come through. Think about this, okay? The very first sin, or we could say the very first rebellion against God, had to do with the idea that rejoicing in the Lord and taking refuge in him wasn't enough, right? God and what he had given to his people there wasn't sufficient. It wasn't enough. The gifts that he had given them, the love that he had shown them, the care that he had for them wasn't enough. They couldn't exist just depending on God, just rejoicing in him and finding their refuge in him. Wouldn't work. And so they went beyond the one boundary that God had put in place. They took the one thing that God told them not to take. They decided that his care for them wasn't going to be sufficient. They found their delight in something beyond what he had placed for them. They thought their desire for knowledge could be satisfied outside of their dependence on God's gifts that he had given to them. They thought they could find refuge for their longings in something outside of God's gifts. But this is the kindness of God, okay? In that rebellious act, God still says this. There's going to be a seed of a woman who's going to crush that serpent that tells you these lies, that God's not enough. that you can't find refuge in him, that rejoicing in him is not the way to go. There's going to be a day when that woman's seed crushes those lies. And a lot of the story of Holy Scripture is simply God's people waiting. And sadly, a lot of the story is in the midst of that long waiting that keeps on going and going. God's people themselves saying, rejoicing in you, maybe I should find something else. Finding my refuge and my satisfaction in you, no. I'm not going to tell you the whole story, but I want to highlight a few major turning points, okay? First, I want to talk about Abraham. God begins this redemptive story. The first 11 chapters basically show you life outside of actually dependence on God is going nowhere good. And then God calls Abraham to himself in Genesis chapter 12, and he says, I'm going to bless you, but my blessing of you is not just for your own sake, but through you I'm going to bless all people. My whole creation is going to be blessed through you. And of course, if you've been hearing the story, you heard, okay, wait, there's going to be a time when the seed of this woman is going to crush the serpent. Maybe all these lies are going to be done away with. So he calls Abraham out of Ur and tells Abram that he's going to bless him. And then in Genesis chapter 15, God makes a covenant, a relational promise with Abraham. It says this, God says, look towards the heavens and number the stars if you're able to number them. Then he said to him, so shall your offspring be. And he believed the Lord, and he counted it to him as righteousness. And then the next verse, verse 7, says this, and he said to him, I'm the Lord your God who brought you out of Ur of the Chaldeans to give you this land to possess. But Abraham can't quite get that land yet because the Lord actually says the sins of the people that live there, they're not great enough that they should be displaced, okay? But here's what I want you to see. God makes a promise to Abram at the time, that's his name, that God's redemption of the whole world, God's love for his creation will come about and he will bless his world and it will happen through this person, Abram. But here's the thing you have to understand. Abram has no children at all. He's like, how in the world is this possible? I'm old. I don't have children. What kind of promises are you making? I don't even have this land because you say, well, the people that live there, their sins aren't too great that they should be removed from this land. I mean, it all seems just a little bit crazy, God's promises. So then, actually, in the next chapter, it actually begins like this. This is what it says. It says, now Sarai, Abram's wife, had borne him no children. It's like right away you're like, wait a second, there's an issue going on here. There's no children here. And you're saying stars of the heavens for offspring. She had a female Egyptian servant whose name was Hagar. And Sarai said to Abram, behold, now the Lord has prevented me from bearing children. Go into my servant. It may be that I shall obtain children by her. And Abram listened to the voice of Sarai. You might know the story here. Ishmael is born to Hagar, not to Sarah, even though the promise is to Abraham and Sarah. And Sarah deals very harshly with this servant, Hagar. It's a very evil story in some ways, but it's also a very beautiful story because the Lord is really kind to Hagar in the midst of this story. But here's what happens, right? The people of God hear God's promises and say, you're taking too long. Refuge in you, rejoicing in you, being actually dependent on your ability. No. Crazy talk. Now, if we jump down a couple chapters in chapter 18, what we find is that the Lord actually comes to Abram again, and he says, hey, this time next year, and by the way, at this point, Abraham is 99 years old. That's kind of old. The Lord comes to Abram and says, hey, this time next year, you know that promise I made to you? Your wife's going to have a child this time. And what does Sarah do? She laughs. Why would you believe God and his promises? Don't you see actually what it says specifically is, the way of woman had ceased to be with Sarah. That's why she laughed. She's like, this is crazy talk. I can't find refuge and rejoice in you and believe your promises because I'm old. All right. I keep going with that story. There's a lot there that's really beautiful. Let me jump ahead significantly to David. By the way, that's jumping about 800 years. Think Abraham, 1800-ish, David, 1000-ish, okay? So in the book of 1 Samuel chapter 16, the prophet Samuel is sent to Jesse, David's father. He has a bunch of other sons, to anoint the next king of Israel. And Samuel doesn't know who he's going to anoint, but it's got to be somebody other than Saul, so he's anointing the next king. And David has all these brothers who are brought forth first. And initially, you know, Samuel's like, oh, these are the kinds of people that should be king. In fact, I heard this sermon once by Eugene Peterson, the guy who wrote The Message. Really wonderful translation of the Bible, loose translation. And he told this story. He said his mom used to tell him all these Bible stories when he was growing up. And his mom was a really good storyteller, which is probably why Eugene Peterson's such a good storyteller. But she would embellish everything. And she would make it a really good story. And so this is kind of how she told the story. She said that the oldest was presented, and he was presented as big and strong and just full of muscle. Somebody that should just be king. But he wasn't chosen. And the next oldest was presented as the one who should maybe be anointed. And he was very smart. He wore a tweed jacket, had horn-rimmed glasses, 3 PhDs. I mean, you should see his home library stacked, right? He wasn't chosen. The next one was presented. He was just smooth, like a good talker, really cool. I mean, he could just like get along with anybody and win anybody over to him. He was a cool cat, not chosen. The next brother was brought forth, and this brother was charismatic. Man, he could work a crowd. If he had an idea and he was like, I got to get people on board with this, everybody was like, sign me up. ESL at Second City, this guy was like, you all would just show up afterwards. And he and you'd be like, let's do it. So every brother was presented, and all of them would have been the good reason. And there would have been a good reason for each one of them to be king. And then after all of them were not chosen, finally, Samuel says, there's something wrong here. He says to Jesse, this is all of your sons? God told me to come here, and these are all great candidates, and yet this is not who I'm supposed to choose. And then Jesse looks confused, and he's like, well, I do have another son. But he's the youngest one. He's the littler one. He's tending the sheep. He's out in the field. We just kind of send him off to do our work because this is the king kind of stuff that you want. If you reject my other sons, there's no way you're going to use this one. Okay, you guys know that King David, the guy who's out in the field tending the sheep, he's actually the one that gets anointed. It's a crazy story. But, okay, here's the wild thing. This is important that you hear this. At the time, King David's like 15 years old. He gets anointed, which is like, why would God work this way? This isn't like how we think he should work, you know. But then actually, he gets anointed, and it's not like he becomes king right away. It's not like you're all of a sudden, you're like, oh, cool, yeah, that guy, obviously Samuel was right. In fact, he has to wait until he's 30. So from 15 till 30, and a lot of that time, if you know the story, Saul's out to kill him. And really, like why I'm telling you this story is that God, we're supposed to rejoice in you and take refuge in you and trust you with all this stuff that doesn't seem to be the way that the world should work. Why do you work this way? And why is your timing like this? And why do you choose these people and say you're going to work in that way? And we go, I don't know. We maybe shouldn't rejoice in you. We shouldn't take refuge in you. Okay, I want to jump ahead again. And I'm going to be brief. Because here's what we find in the storyline of the Bible. Is the vast majority of the time, God's people said things like, Well, they said, God, you're not really enough. Trusting you and believing your promises, they're not sufficient. They don't give us our desires, and your timing is so off, and the difficulty is so great. One of the promises to David, actually, if you continue to read his story in 2 Samuel chapter 7, in the covenant, the relationship, you know, with God, the promises, the relational promises that God makes to David is there's going to be a king forever on your throne. But then if you keep reading ahead, what you find is tons of those kings actually want nothing to do with God. They look at the other nations and they're like, those people have it going. They look wealthy and happy and they're worshiping other gods. Maybe we should give up on this God. And that's largely what happened with most of the story of the Old Testament. God's people decide that his promises for them, they're not enough. His goodness is not good enough. They might as well just live like the other people around them. And then out of that, God actually exiles the 10 northern tribes. The Assyrians come in 721, take the 10 northern tribes of Israel away. And then in 586, really like 590s, 580s BC, the Babylonians come and they take the two southern tribes away, Judah, where Jerusalem was, and Benjamin, and they're gone. Why do I share all this? What are the promises that we've heard from God? You're going to be a people that are going to bless the nations. You're going to have this land. The promise to David, there's going to be a king forever on the throne. And now you're left and you're like, this is crazy talk. How are we supposed to rejoice in you, Lord? How are we supposed to find our refuge in you? We're told here in Psalm 64, let the righteous rejoice in the Lord and take refuge in him. But even as we consider the story of the Bible, what we see is that the waiting is long for Abram and Sarah. And their temptation is to take matters into their own hands. Or what we see in David is God choosing the one that we least expect, and we want to put other people forward and say, God, what are you doing? And what we see in the exile is God's people actually do plot against God's ways, and they think, no, his plan is not right. Refuge in him is not a good idea. What we read in Psalm 64 is what appears to be a long time of crying out to the Lord. Most of this psalm, I wonder if you notice this, if you look at it, just look at it with me, not even read it. Most of it is this part where all the plotting is happening. I mean, the first six verses, there's only 10 verses, it's a short psalm, and the first six verses are all of David saying like, man, this person's doing this, or like this is happening, and this is happening, and this is happening, and it just seems like it builds up, and it's, most of the psalm is just, why is all this going on? Where are you? What are you going to do? Listen to this again. Okay, let me read it again. Hear my voice, O God, in my complaint, which is a great way, you know, you're like gathering kids together. Kids, y'all, I'm sure the kids in this church have never had this happen. Parents come around, they're like, hey, you need to listen to me. They normally don't say that the first time, right? That's normally like a build-up kind of thing. Like, hear my voice. Preserve my life from dread of the enemy. Hide me from the secret plots of the wicked, from the throngs of evildoers, who whet their tongues like swords, who aim bitter words like arrows, shooting from ambush at the blameless, shooting at him suddenly and without fear, they hold fast their evil purposes. They talk of laying snares secretly, thinking who can see them. They search out injustice, saying, we have accomplished a diligent search. The inward mind and heart of man are deep. Let the righteous one rejoice in the Lord and take refuge in him. But the injustices of the wicked keep coming. They just keep coming and keep coming and keep coming. We read about that, read about them all of the time. And the waiting for the Lord is so long. It is. And the temptation is sometimes to think what God has given to me is not enough. And maybe the fulfillment of his promises won't happen. They seem so distant. And Galatians 4:4 says this, but when the fullness of time had come, which is like right when God knows when he's going to act, at the perfect time, God sent his son, born of a woman, born under the law, to redeem those who were under the law. God knew exactly when Jesus would be sent. It's not haphazard. It's not lost on God that the waiting is really long. Probably a lot of you know that the New Testament begins like this. Abraham had Isaac. Isaac, he had Jacob. Jacob, he had Judah and his kin. Then Perez and Zerah came from Judah. Judah's woman, Tamar. Perez, he brought Hezra up and then came. It's a song. You don't know that song. Okay, it's all right. I'm just going to read it. And then came Hezron, the father of Ram, and Ram, the father of Amminadab, and Amminadab, the father of Nahshon, and Nahshon, the father of Salmon, and Salmon, the father of Boaz by Rahab, and Boaz, the father of Obed by Ruth, and Obed, the father of Jesse, and Jesse, the father of David, the king. And David was the father of Solomon by the wife of Uriah, and Solomon, the father of Rehoboam, and Rehoboam, the father of Abijah, and Abijah, the father of Asaph, and Asaph, the father of Jehoshaphat, and Jehoshaphat, the father of Joram, and Joram, the father of Uzziah, and Uzziah, the father of Jotham, and Jotham, the father of Ahaz, and Ahaz, the father of Hezekiah, and Hezekiah, the father of Manasseh, and Manasseh, the father of Amos, and Amos, the father of Josiah, and Josiah, the father of Jeconiah, and his brothers at the time of the deportation to Babylon. Collective breath. And after the deportation of Babylon, Jeconiah was the father of Shealtiel, and Shealtiel the father of Zerubbabel, and Zerubbabel the father of Abiad, and Abiad the father of Eliakim, and Eliakim the father of Azor, and Azor the father of Zadok, and Zadok the father of Achim, and Achim the father of Eliad, and Eliad the father of Eleazar, and Eleazar the father of Matan, and Matan the father of Jacob, and Jacob the father of Joseph, and Joseph the father of Mary, of whom Jesus was born, who's called Christ. So all the generations from Abraham to David were 14 generations. And from David to the deportation to Babylon, 14 generations. And from the deportation to Babylon to the Christ, 14 generations. That's a long time. How many of you were wishing I would stop or wondering if I would stop? That's a lot of names, and it's a long time, and that's actually part of the point. But when God acts, even acts suddenly, he acts decisively and purposefully, and he accomplishes what he intends to accomplish, which is he sends his very son to die and to rise again and to conquer Satan, sin, and death on the cross. His timing is always perfect. And that's actually part of the point of Matthew chapter 1. 14 generations and 14 generations and 14 generations, which is to say 7 plus 7 plus 7 plus 7 plus 7 plus 7 into the seventh generation. And if you know the Bible, 7 is the number of perfection, which is to say God knows exactly what he's doing. He knows exactly what he's doing. And you're like, what is happening? Why should I rejoice in you and take refuge in you? Because, man, the waiting is long. Verse 7, after all of this, says this. But God shoots his arrows at them. They are wounded suddenly. They're plotting and scheming and this and this and this and this. All this stuff is happening. And when God acts, he knows exactly what he's doing. They're brought to ruin. Friends, brothers and sisters, I think this is what Psalm 64 is telling us. Let the righteous one rejoice in the Lord. Take refuge in him. Because he will come through. He will. He will come through. God knows exactly what he's doing. He's enough. His care for you is perfect. It is. He's always enough. His timing might seem totally off to us. It's always perfect. It's always in the fullness of time that he acts. I mean, come on. Some of you are waiting and waiting and waiting. I would guess all of us have different waitings that we have been waiting in for a long, long time. Maybe it's just for your tears to stop generally. Maybe it's for your tears to stop specifically about a specific thing that you have been waiting in forever. Maybe it's you're waiting for that specific struggle against sin to be done with, or maybe it's you're waiting for the injustices of the world to finally come to an end, for God to make good on blessing the nations fully, completely. Maybe you're waiting for your body to work, your mind just to ease, for your heart to be at peace. But I want you to hear, God will do it. He makes good on his promises, and he will act, and when he does, it will bring about exactly what he wants to do. He will come. When he comes to make all things new, to bring all wrongs to right, and to wipe away every tear and sorrow, to do away with all the pain of this world, he will come in the perfect timing, and he will act decisively, and he will accomplish exactly what he wants to do, and his timing will be perfect, and it will be full. Listen, let the righteous one rejoice and take refuge in him. Let me pray for us. Lord, thank you for this psalm. Lord, we might not have people scheming against us. Some of us might. Seeking to shoot us down with arrows. But, oh Lord, how the long wait of our redemption, how the long wait of the blessing of the nations and the good of your perfect kingdom to be over all things is in each one of our hearts. How we ache with the desire for you to act fully. God, I pray that we would put our trust in you, that we would rejoice in you, that you would be our refuge. Because we know that when you act perfectly and your timing is always right. God, for some of us, I pray that you'd act really soon. Hearts are heavy, Lord. Desires have been long held. We are waiting, Lord. For all of us, we cry out with the church, Maranatha, Lord, come. Please. God, I pray for each one of us that in our waiting, we would not lose heart. We would not find the allure of the world so tempting that we fall and we leave you. Or that we don't take measures into our own hands in such a way that goes against your law and your goodness for us. God, sustain us in the waiting. And make good, Lord. Make good and act decisively for our good. We pray this in Jesus' name, the one who is given in the fullness of time to redeem us. We bless you and we praise you. Amen.
Stand with me as we affirm the faith of the church together. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary,
suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again from the dead. He ascended to heaven and is seated at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From there, he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Amen.
Together, let us offer up the prayers of the people, and in doing so, let's give our hearts to remember the physical needs of our church body, such as Peter mentioned, Christine and Mary, as well as those whose hearts are heavy with grief and suffering and sadness. We can remember Barb. And also for the preparation of our community and our church body as we are transitioning back to school for our students, for our parents, for our teachers. Let's remember them as we pray for our church. In peace, we pray to you, Lord God, for all people in their daily life and work, for our families, friends, and neighbors, and for those who are alone. For all those who labor in education, for students, teachers, administrators in this year ahead. For this community, the nation, and the world.
For all who work for justice, freedom, and peace.
For the just and proper use of your creation. For the victims of hunger, fear, injustice, and oppression. For all who are in danger, sorrow, or in any kind of trouble. For those who minister to the sick, the friendless, and the needy. For the peace and unity of the Church of God. For all who proclaim the gospel, and who
all who seek the truth.
For the special needs and concerns of this congregation, we pray especially for. Hear us, Lord, for your mercy is great. We thank you, Lord, for all the blessings of this life. We will exalt you, O God our King, and praise your name forever and ever. The book of Hebrews says to keep your life free from love of money and be content with what you have. For he has said, I will never leave you nor forsake you. So let's take a moment while I pray for our tithes and offerings. God, let the Spirit open our hearts and our hands so that we can freely give to you that which you have freely given us. May our gifts, our tithes, and our first fruits be used to further your kingdom and to love our community and your people. We ask this in your heavenly name. Amen.
The doxology together. Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise him, all creatures here below. Praise him above ye heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen. We come now to celebrate the Lord's table. We celebrate in the body and blood of Christ that God did act decisively and definitively in Jesus, that when he went to the cross, he conquered it. He rose again to new life. And I say this often, but I think this is worth repeating, that the Lord gives us this table because he knows that the waiting is long. He gives us something to eat because he knows we need to be sustained. And we need to be sustained with this reality that God has decisively acted in Christ. His death and his resurrection are the first fruits of the new creation. They're just the beginning. He will come. He will act. He will make good on every single one of his promises. And the great reassurance that we have of that is his broken body, his resurrected body. And we celebrate that in taking the bread and taking the wine and eating and being nourished for the long journey. So if you believe in this reality that Christ died for you, you've been baptized and you belong to his church, then come and take of these things. If you don't, you're just checking them out, come forward. We would like to pray for you up here, or maybe just stay seated and contemplate these realities of God's working. This is for those who love and trust and belong to Jesus. Brothers and sisters, the Lord be with you.
And also thank with you.
Lift up your hearts.
Lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right for us to give thanks and praise.
It is. Creating and redeeming God, in Adam, Abraham, and Moses, in Deborah, Esther, and Mary, you've chosen not simply to direct the course of events, but to be in relationship with us and to entrust your children with the embodiment and exercise of your will. In the dying and rising Christ, you give us not just a savior, but an example. And in every generation, you call people to imitate the pattern of his life and death and to witness to your glory. You call us to be not heroes who go it alone, but saints whose every breath depends on others and on you. We rejoice in the saints who have taken their place in the company of heaven, and we join them singing the hymn of your unending praise.
Holy, holy, holy Lord God of power and might, heaven and earth, heaven and earth are filled of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest.
Lord, on the night in which he was betrayed, he took bread, and having blessed it, he broke it, and he gave it to his disciples, and he said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." After the supper, the Lord took the cup and said, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood shed for the forgiveness of sins." And the Apostle Paul adds that as often as we eat this bread and we drink this cup, that we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes again. Therefore, let us proclaim the mystery of our faith as signed and sealed in this sacrament.
Christ has died.
Christ is risen.
Christ will come again.
Lord, we do long for your return. Our bodies ache with our longings sometimes, and our hearts are all a mess sometimes, and our minds desire it more than we possibly imagine at times, Lord. Come again, Lord. Maranatha. Jesus, we bless you that you did not leave us alone. That you, as you told your disciples there in the upper room long ago, that you're giving the helper, the comforter, the guide to them. And so, Spirit, we bless you this morning. We worship you, Holy Spirit. We thank you, Holy Spirit, that you abide within us, that you've made your dwelling in us, the temples of the living God. Spirit, give us faith now, that in coming to this table, that we might receive this bread and this wine, and they might be for us the body and blood of Christ. That we, as the people of the Spirit, might be the body of Christ, redeemed by the blood of Christ. We pray this in Jesus' name, and we pray as he taught us, saying, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name.
Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen."
Brothers and sisters, these are the gifts of God for the people of God. Take them in remembrance that Christ died for you, and feed on him by faith with thanksgiving. Let's come to the table of the Lord.
Be still, my soul, the Lord is on your side. Bear patiently the cross of grief or pain. Leave to your God to faithful will remain. be still, my soul, when dearest friends depart, and all is dark and in the veil of tears, then shall you better know his love is on, who comes to soothe your soul.
Gifts coming down here. One of them is not how tight it gets up here. Stand with me. Let's close our worship with this prayer. Almighty God, Father of all mercies, we are unworthy servants, give you humble thanks. For all your goodness and loving kindness to us and to all whom you have made, we bless you for our creation, preservation, and all the blessings of this life. But above all, for your immeasurable love and the redemption of the world by our Lord Jesus Christ, for the means of grace and for the hope of glory. And we pray, give us such an awareness of your mercies that with truly thankful hearts, we may show forth your praise, not only with our lips, but in our lives, by giving up ourselves to your service, and by walking before you in holiness and righteousness all our days. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit be honor and glory throughout all ages. Amen. Receive God's word of blessing upon you. Lord bless you and keep you. Lord, make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up the light of his countenance upon you and give you his peace. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, amen.
Amen. Let's sing this last song together.
safe and secure from all alarms, leaning on the everlasting arms.
Amen.
A reminder, with logos around, we have to take up chairs. We don't have to put down tables, but it'd be helpful. So you can assume, actually, that most of this side of the chairs don't have to get put up. These ones do. Meet over here to learn more about English as a second language learning.